Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J addresses law students participating in the Alliance Defending Freedom's Blackstone Legal Fellowship. In the first part of her talk, she lays the groundwork for the social significance of the family as developed in her book, Love and Economics.
Interestingly, the providence of God, the European Court of Human Rights today just said that a state, a nation state, limiting marriage to one man and one woman does not impermissibly discriminate. So to the extent SCOTUS wants to follow the European model, I invite them to consider it. And that was involving France. Very interesting. So it was a Sarkozy type of deal. Anyway, now we're going to talk about why marriage matters. It's not just a legal question, it's a human question. Jennifer Roback Morse, professionally trained as an economist, the founder of the Ruth Institute, taught at both Yale and George Mason, has a fascinating perspective on this. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks for being here, everybody. It's a real joy to come to Blackstone every year. I've been part of this for a number of years now, part of the Collegiate Academy as well. I know I've met a few of you at Collegiate Academy events. And so it's really a pleasure to be able to address you about the very important topic of marriage, how you can make the case for marriage both in terms of public policy and in terms of personal strategies. So those of you who've heard me at Collegiate Academy and those of you on the staff who've heard me every year, I always say the same thing, but it's different every time. So go figure. That's because some truths are eternal, and yet there's always something new going on that needs to be explicated. So that's where we are today. Sign up for the Ruth Institute's electronic newsletter list. So if you wouldn't mind circulating that, all we need is your name and your email address, and you can become very well informed about every aspect of the marriage movement all around the world, because our newsletter touches on every aspect of marriage, and we talk about issues going on all over the world. So as you'll see, I don't take a narrow view of what this is about and what it entails. And as Jeff mentioned, I am not a lawyer. I am not now, nor have I ever been an attorney. And so my perspective on these matters is a little bit different from the one that you're all training for. My training is in the social science, and so I'm interested in how changes in one part of the social world have consequences and ripple effects all the way through other parts of the social world. Whereas a lot of times lawyers, particularly those involved in court cases and legislation, will be focused very narrowly on the text of the statute and saying, well, what does the statute actually do? What does Congress actually intend? And so on, which is the most narrow reading of the thing. But if you're going to do responsible public policy, you have to realize that when you change one little thing over here, legally it may look like one little thing, but in fact it can cascade all through the society. And you need to have both of those perspectives to really do a good job. So what we're going to do here is I have 2 hours to spend with you. The first hour, this is the outline for the first hour. We'll be talking about why the family is the basis for society. And in this material, this is the material that hardly ever changes very much, because this is truly foundational material that you need to have in your mind and in your heart in order to go forward with whatever the current challenge might be. I will talk for about 30 to 45 minutes on this material, and then we'll have time for questions on this material. After the break, there'll be a 15-minute break. After the break, we will talk about things relating to same-sex marriage and transgenderism and those type of topics, which are on everybody's mind. So if you don't mind, I would like you to hold off your questions about those issues until the second half of the presentation, and you will see that there is plenty to talk about just on these things, but they tend to get overshadowed by the things that are so current. So we're going to talk about the sociological reasons why what the family ought to be, what we need the family to be, and the natural order. Why in the natural order do we need the family? Do we always observe the family? Then I'm going to speak to you just a little bit about the supernatural order. talk to you just a little bit about theology. And then finally, I'm going to close this part of the presentation by looking at three threats to freedom that can come about that I believe are directly in the crosshairs of our current sexual revolutionary ideology, that this is not a freedom-loving, freedom-enhancing movement, that there are very serious threats to individual liberty that are part and parcel of the sexual revolution and everything that's involved in it. So let's first talk about what the family ought to be, the sociological answer in the natural realm. I'm going to start by just telling you a little bit about myself and how a person gets from being a professor at a major university like George Mason University. I notice we have some George Mason people here. Do we have any patrons? Just one? What the heck? Okay. And then we have a few Yale people here. Is that right? From Yale Law? We have a few. Okay. So how does a career trajectory work, you know, where you start out getting tenure at teaching at Yale, getting tenure at a major university, and then you end up becoming a radical advocate for the family, so radical that I'm on the hate lists and stuff. I'm actually listed as a hate group. If you want to leave now, you can, just now that I've given you full warning. I'm actually a hate group listed by the Southern Poverty Law Center. When I got on that group, on that list, some of my friends said to me, "Don't let anybody on this list. You're way too nice. You don't belong on this list at all." You know, I'm like, okay, well, whatever. What can I say? Well, so look at my plan for myself. This is back in the 1980s, so I'm not going to tell you how old I am. You can do the math yourself. Back in the 1980s, my plan for myself was that I was going to get tenure at a major. I would get my doctorate, get tenure at a major university, and then I would have a baby. I would have a baby. Now, I was already married. Back in those days, you were supposed to be married before you had any kids. So I had completed step one. I was married. But, you know, my thoughts were really oriented toward myself and my career. I will just tell you that. And I think that's still a problem for a lot of people. But anyway, so my thought was I would get pregnant. As soon as I got tenure, I would get pregnant at, like, right in May or June, you know, the beginning of the summer, and then I would take care of the baby during the summer, and then in September, I would put the baby in daycare, and I would go right back to work, never miss a day of work. All my colleagues did that. George Mason Law, I had a number of female, George Mason Econ Department had a number of female colleagues. Amongst them, they had probably had 10 children amongst them. None of them ever missed a day of work. That was, you know, the ethos. We were supposed to prove we were one of the guys, you know, and get back in the saddle and ride and all that stuff. Well, imagine my surprise when the baby did not come during the month that I had set aside for it. Okay, now, you guys, seriously, when I give this talk to adults, a room full of, you know, people in their middle age, they have already started laughing at me. Way back when I said I was going to, when I had the month picked out that I was going to have the baby, the adults always laugh at that. Now, you guys need to realize that was a laugh line, and I'm a little worried about you now. I don't know what you're thinking. Maybe some of y'all have a plan like that, you know? I don't know. So, I mean, it's a very common plan, right, for girls on a professional track. We, you know, we're inclined to think like this. So anyway, so imagine my surprise when the baby didn't arrive when I had planned for it, and my husband and I found ourselves facing an infertility crisis, which is a miserable experience, and one we were truly not prepared for, and the one that turned out to last about 4.5 years. And it was during that period of time that I came back to the practice of the faith. Because that, for me, was the first time in my adult life that I couldn't get what I wanted by trying harder, working hard, following all the rules, and so on. I was used to controlling all the outcomes of my life by doing what I was supposed to do. And this is the first, this is like a big shock, you know. So it turns out, however, I will just warn, is anybody here already a parent? I know a few of you are married, and so some of you have kids. Okay, great, that's great. You know then that thinking you're going to have everything your own way is like something you have to get out of your mind before children ever arrive, right, fellows? Right. I mean, like, infertility actually is good preparation for parenthood in that sense, because you're not going to control all the outcomes once kids come. You know, that's just not going to happen. But anyway, so as I said, I found myself back in the practice of my faith, which for me, the faith of my childhood was the Catholic faith. And so I... during that long journey of infertility, there was a big spiritual component of it, which brought me back to faith. But we ended up resolving our infertility crisis in 1991, we decided that we would adopt a child from a Romanian orphanage. That was, if you think about the date, that was right after the Berlin Wall had come down, the Ceausescus had been assassinated by their own people, and so on. And it was just starting to come out in the news that there were these little children who were available for adoption in Romania. And so in January of 1991, we received a phone call from the adoption agency saying, "We have a little boy for you. We know his name, his birthday. He's described as being in good health. He will be 2.5 years old when you get him, probably in April. What do you say?" And we said, "Sure, why not? We'll take the little boy." When you've been infertile for 4 years, you don't really believe a child will come, you know? So it's like, yeah, okay, whatever. You know, we'll take the little boy. That's great. And then 10 days later, I went to the doctor with a head cold and found out that I was pregnant. So we ended up having 2 children within 6 months' time, which is a record even for a Catholic. Now, that laugh line always works. that one always works. Before I go any further with this story, I have to tell you, yeah, this is how I knew I was back in the faith, you know, that and these kids like this, you know. Before I go any further, I have to tell you that my son is now doing fine. Okay, so I'm going to say some scary things, but he is doing fine. I just want you to know that. So in case I forget, he's 27 years old, and he's, you know, he's doing great. He's amazing how great he's doing. It's wonderful. But I have to tell you that when these 2 children arrived in our home, my husband and I were really not prepared. So, for example, our little boy, at the age of 2.5, did not utter a single sound in any language. He did not know his own name. He did not turn to the sound of the human voice. So if you call him by name, he wouldn't even turn and look at you, okay? So probably, you know, if you have little brothers and sisters, you probably know that's not normal. You know, that is not normal for a 2.5-year-old child. But we didn't know that, see. My doctorate in economics did not prepare me for what I had to deal with here. My husband is an engineer, if anything, less prepared for what we had to deal with. And so here we are, a pair of nerds, you know, and nerd is a good thing, right? We have any self-proclaimed nerds out there? Right on. My data people, okay, that's all good. So, yeah, you know, here we are with a pair of nerds with these 2 children in our home. And, of course, naturally, we see a controlled experiment. And the controlled experiment is, what difference does it make whether you have a mom and a dad in your life? Say, what difference does it make whether you have a mom and a dad in your life? And of course, the answer is, it makes all the difference. It makes an enormous difference. Let me give you just a couple little examples of things. When my daughter was about 6 months old, she's laying on the bed, and my husband changing her diaper, and he starts tossing a little cloth over her face to play what? What do you do when you do that? You play peekaboo. And she's laughing her head off and tossing that little cloth back, right? We go to put the cloth on our little boy's face, who's now about 3 years old, to try to play peekaboo with him. He was scared. He was scared to have his face covered. See, just little stuff like that, that shows you something profound, really profound, has happened to this child through profound neglect. Don't ever say the child was just neglected. He wasn't really abused. He was just neglected. You know what? Neglect is abuse. Okay? Neglect is really, really profound. So in the course of trying to help our little boy, who's now a big boy, who's now a grown man, in the course of trying to help him, we learned a lot of things about child development that we wouldn't have known if we hadn't, you know, if I had done my plan of having one child and putting her in daycare, I would never have known any of this stuff. First thing you learn is that boys and girls really truly are different. I think this is a good time to mention this fact. Are you guys aware that boys and girls are different? Men and women are different and stuff? Okay, the child development people will tell you every major developmental milestone comes in on average at a different time for boys and for girls. So girls will talk sooner, boys will get their gross motor movements in sooner. You know, I mean, it's just... So if you've got a four-year-old boy who's not talking, it doesn't mean the same thing as if you have a four-year-old girl who's not talking, right? So boys and girls are different, so that's okay, that's important. I had to get that off my chest in the light of current events. But there are two really scary things that can happen to a child who does not have parents taking care of him. And in order to see this, let's think through what happens with a child normally. Normally, what will happen is the baby cries. Something happens, they are hungry, their diaper's wet, something happens, they cry. Or maybe they're just lonely. They cry, and what normally happens? Whoosh, somebody zooms in, picks up the baby, works out whatever it is, takes care of the baby, laughs, plays, looks at him, has a great time taking care of that baby and his needs, okay? And every time somebody whoosh, whoops in there, what you're doing is building trust with that child. You don't realize it, but you are, because now the child sees that it's okay to be needy, it's okay to be dependent, and the world is basically a pretty good place. You scream, somebody shows up. It's great. You know, it's like living in the Ritz, you know? But for the child who's left in the orphanage, in the crib by themselves, they cry, and nobody comes. See, nobody comes. Somebody will come at the end of the day to change their diaper, whether they need it or not. Somebody will come two or three times a day to feed them, whether they need it or not. They might even just take the bottle and put it in the crib and kind of wire it to the bars of the crib, and the kid can just eat whenever they want. They just kind of, you know, one adoptive mom that I know whose child, you know, had a Romanian child, she said, my son was fed like a hamster. That's what it's like, okay? So that child, he stops crying. He stops crying because nobody comes. Nobody comes. And so what happens with that child is that child starts to turn inward. That child starts to retreat because the world isn't really safe for him. He's right. The world isn't really safe for that little guy from his little perspective and his little mind. See, he's not verbal, he's not rational, he's not cognitive, but he's putting all this stuff together about what the world is really like and what his place in it really is. Now, it turns out that when you are being cared for by your mom and you're learning to trust her, one of the things that happens is you build the groundwork for the foundation of a conscience and conscience development. And here's how it works. When a child's really little, they can't really do anything wrong, per se, right? I mean, they're just kind of there, and you're kind of taking care of them, you know, and all that. Well, as soon as they can walk around and stuff, they can get into trouble. And so when they get into trouble, what do you do first of all? You pick them up, you get them out of trouble, and you say, don't do that anymore, right? They throw stuff, you pick them up, you put them in timeout, right? You go, and you deal with whatever it is. You protect them, you protect others, and you're teaching them how to behave. Well, part of the reason that works is because a little child wants to please you, the mommy, okay? The child wants to please their mommy. Why does he want to please the mommy? Because in his mind, mom is the source of life, which is true. Mom is the source of life, right? And so eventually, you don't have to go pick him up. You can just speak across the room, and he'll listen, and he'll maybe, you know, give you this look and stop whatever he's doing. Eventually, you don't have to speak. You just give him a stink eye, right? And they shape up. They drop whatever they're doing, you know. And when they get really older, grown up people, you don't have to do anything anymore because your concept of right and wrong is internalized into the child, right? And so by the time a person is your age, the age of you guys, you're not consciously thinking about your mom and dad, but the fact is you don't even consider doing certain kinds of things. You're not even considering whether you can get away with stealing the towels in this hotel or whatever. Just not even on your mind, right? Because I'm not the kind of person who would do a thing like that. You know, getting away with it, you know, it's not even on the radar, right? But for any of that to happen, you got to care about your mom. You got to care about somebody. It's got to matter to you whether she gives you the stink eye, right? Whether she is mad at you. So now you go back to your little child in the crib and nobody coming. What happens with that child is he doesn't give a rip what anybody thinks, see? And when he's able to get up and walk around and do stuff, he may not care if he hurts anybody else. If he's been in an orphanage for a long period of time, if he's been in and out of foster care, if he's been cared for by parents who aren't really caring very much but who are preoccupied with other things and are not very responsive, what will happen or what can happen with a child in that situation, they don't care what anybody thinks of them. And so therefore, they have no basis for internalizing conscience and self-control and self-command. And when that happens, you've got a condition called attachment disorder. You can write this down, attachment disorder. Attachment disorder is a very scary diagnosis because it means that you've got a child without a conscience. If you've got a child without a conscience who's 4 years old, you can pick them up and get them out of trouble. When they're 14, it's not so easy to do that. And in fact, what might happen if you've got a real bad case of it is that that older child gets bigger than their mom, is able to push people around, and when he finally gets into trouble with the law, the family's kind of relieved because maybe he's in jail now and he's not going to hurt anybody and we're not going to get hurt and he'll be cared for at least over there. You know, it's a very scary and sad diagnosis, and it's terrifying for an adoptive parent or a foster parent when you think that this may be coming down the pike at you. So it takes a lot of intervention to deal with it. But why am I bringing it up? Because all along, we have been counting on moms and dads attaching to their children. This never entered John Locke's mind, I'm sure, or Thomas Hobbes, or any of these other social contract theorists. It never entered their mind where adults come from, to ask the question, where do adults come from? I can tell you for sure in economics, we have no idea where adults come from, okay? Homo economicus, do we have any econ majors here, any undergraduate econ majors? Yeah. Homo economicus is just, he's just there, and he's able to negotiate contracts, he's able to interact with people, he's got a bank account, he can talk, he's got citizenship papers, the whole thing, you know? We have no idea where that 18-year-old comes from, right? But the fact is, in order for any of that to get started, he had to have a mom and dad taking personal care of him so that he would give a rip whether he breaks his promises or not. Say, we're counting on all that to be there. So this was the thing, when I learned about attachment disorder and I looked into my own profession, I realized this is what we were all missing, right? And it was extremely important. So that's one point, is attachment disorder. The second thing I'm going to mention briefly is something called institutional autism. And this has to do with the development of the brain, all right? So it turns out that you probably have all heard many times that the human brain is not fully developed at birth, right? If it were fully developed at birth, your head would be too big to make it down the birth canal. You would kill your mother in the process. This would obviously be a design flaw. And so when you're born, the part of your brain that needs to be developed turns out to be the part of the brain that governs your ability to interact with others. It's a part of the brain called the limbic brain. It's not the part that allows you to balance a checkbook or play chess or that kind of stuff. It's not cognitive. It has to do with your ability to interact with others, interpret faces, intuit what's going on, get the vibe if there's something going on in the room, you know, if everybody's all excited, we're all cheering for the Redskins or whatever, you know, that it's more exciting if everybody's all cheering for Notre Dame. Will that get a rise from anybody? I'm just trying to see. Is anybody awake? Yeah, nobody's into the Redskins, I guess, even though this is D.C. But anyway, so that part of the brain, how does it develop? It develops right here, right here. You got your baby right here. And what do when you've got a baby in your arms? You look at him. You look at him when you're holding the baby, when you're rocking the baby. Their brain is developing. That part of the brain that governs relationship, that limbic brain, that's what's developing. So over in the Eastern European orphanages, they got over there and they found whole rooms full of kids who looked like they were autistic. And their thought was, these kids didn't need to be autistic. This was somehow developed. Now, if any of you have autistic brothers or sisters, don't mistake me. Some people are born with autism. Some people are born with it, but it can be made also, right, if you don't have the proper development. So think about what people do. You're looking at them all the time. You're responding to them. So you're changing their diapers, and you're going, you're doing all that stuff with them, right? You're developing their brain as you're doing that. You're doing your dishes. They're sitting over there in the rockeroo. You're doing their dishes, and they go, blah, 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 and you go, blah, blah, blah. You're having a conversation with them. You're developing them and their personhood and their brain all just by your interaction with them. It's a beautiful, wonderful reality. And if you turned social scientists loose with clipboards and asked that lady to do a time study. How did you spend your time today? Oh, I did the dishes. She would never write down the fact that she was talking to her baby the whole time. She did not engage in any meaningful child care during this period of time. She was doing the dishes. You know, that doesn't work. That kind of analysis, that kind of thinking, it doesn't work. So, that's why I am convinced that children need their own mothers and fathers. Children need their own mothers and fathers. I could be wrong about many things in my life. I have been wrong about many things in my life. But I'm not wrong about this. Kids need their mothers and fathers. So for further reading about this, you can look to these resources. By the way, if you sign up on my newsletter, I will send you a PDF copy of this PowerPoint, and it has all of these references in it. So do be sure to circulate those green sheets. And then also, this was my first book, Love and Economics. I really talked about in that book attachment and attachment disorder. So I know you guys get something from me. It might be smart sex that you guys receive. I'll talk more about that book later. But this book is I would say, the foundation of what I do. So now, let's talk just for a moment about a theological answer to the question of what should the family be in the theological realm. What does our common religion have to say about this? And by the way, I'm aware that you guys, that we here in this room all come from a variety of religious traditions, but we're all under the broad Christian umbrella. And I think all of our churches would say pretty much the same thing that I'm about to say here. Okay, so it's not a uniquely Catholic thing. In the Bible, it says that it's not good for man to be alone. But what I just said shows you that modern neuroscience convinces us that it's not even possible for man to be alone. If you're left alone, you're going to die. The left alone baby dies. I didn't even mention the failure to thrive syndrome, whereby if the child is not held or touched or picked up, they waste away. Okay, they can die from having no discernible illness. So infants attach to their mothers. That's a form of love, right? It's a way of loving. And then we can talk also, and in Smart Sex I do talk about this, that sex partners attach to one another physically, chemically, biologically, hormonally. We attach to our sex partners. It's the most natural thing in the world. And so what that means is that we are meant for love. It is hardwired into our biology. Science is now showing us this, that the human person is meant for love, which all of our religions have always taught, whatever denominational background you might have. All Christianity teaches that the human person is meant for love. And I love this quote from Pope St. John Paul II. Man cannot live without love. He remains a being that is incomprehensible for himself. His life is senseless if love is not revealed to him, if he does not encounter love, if he does not experience it and make it his own. He could be, now what he goes on to talk about how we all need to be saved by Jesus Christ, right? But he could be talking about my little attachment disordered orphan. You see, their little lives are senseless to them until they encounter love in the form of a live person who cares about them. And so Pope John Paul has a whole, develops this in a very profound way in the theology of the body, what is called the theology of the body. The book is called Male and Female, He Created Them. Some of you are perhaps familiar with it. Those of you who are not familiar with it, I think you would find it very profound because it's all scripture. You know, it's all based on scripture and very profound reflections on the passages of scripture that pertain to these matters. So now I want to just make one final point in this area. When I visited Hong Kong Baptist University in 2011, I didn't know there was such a thing as Hong Kong Baptist University till I got over there. But anyway, Hong Kong Baptist University, I was introduced to a number of Chinese Christians, and they mentioned that in the Confucian religion, there's some way in which the sex and marriage reflect the cosmos. And I thought, wow, that's really interesting. And then I started thinking about it some more. I go, well, you know, as Christians, we think that too. We believe that sex and marriage somehow reflect the cosmos. St. Paul is very explicit about it in Ephesians 5, where he talks about Jesus and the church and the relationship between husband and wife reflecting the relationship between Christ and the church. And the way I spoke just a few moments ago is completely consistent with Christian theology, that we believe as Christians that the world was created, that God created the world out of nothing as an act of love, right? And so at the heart of the cosmos, in our view, is love. Now, compare that with what some of your classmates might think. Some of your classmates who don't believe in God, who certainly don't believe in the Christian God, they may believe that the cosmos was created by accident, by random atoms bumping into each other, and in some way that their sex lives reflect that view of the cosmos. Your sex life, for a lot of unchurched people, is a couple of random atoms bumping into each other for no particular reason at all. The act has no meaning, and there certainly is no love at the center of the cosmos or in the center of what you're doing sexually. So I'll just give you that to ponder on, to meditate on, and you just realize in your heart that our view is certainly more appealing. Our view is attractive. You don't need to be afraid to say, look, this is what I believe. I believe at the heart of the cosmos is a deep, unending love. What do you think is at the heart of the cosmos? You know? And I'm pretty sure they don't have anything quite that good to offer. I'm pretty sure. Now let's talk about the three threats to freedom that I believe are latent, or perhaps worse, in our current drive to reconfigure marriage and the family and everything else. So the first thing, I'm going to start with kind of the most obvious and superficial and go to what I believe are more profound and a little bit more subtle. Okay, so let's start with the obvious, the fiscal implications of family breakdown. The fiscal implications of family breakdown is something that you can bring up to even your most libertarian colleagues in your Federalist Society chapters, okay? Because this is something they can relate to. They can relate to taxpayer burden and things like that, right? Do any of you have friends like that who think they think you're nuts for caring about the social issues, but they're really hyped up about the national debt or something like that? You have colleagues? Yeah, everybody's got friends like that, okay? So here's the thing. When mom and dad are taking care of their child, they're keeping the child out of the social service network, right? If mom and dad are not there taking care of the child, the child is now at risk for a whole series of bad outcomes, negative outcomes, and very often the public sector ends up being involved in correcting those outcomes, okay? So I can tell you for our little boy, we used a lot of public services. You know, we went to a public health clinic for a speech therapy. He was in special education. Lots and lots of services had to go into making up for what he should have had from his own mom and dad in the first place, okay? And there are many parallels to that. In fact, it has been studied. Somebody looked at the taxpayer cost of family breakdown. This includes single parenthood and divorce, and it was looking at the fact that people are more likely to end up in poverty if the child is more likely to end up in poverty if their parents are not married, and a few other indicators like that. And so they were looking at health, education, mental health, and of course crime associated with family breakdown. And the estimate that they came up with, and this has been almost 10 years ago now, $112 billion per year, billion with a B, $112 billion per year in state, federal, and local costs associated with family breakdown. That is the GDP of New Zealand. This is not chump change that we're talking about here. Just to give you one very concrete example, a few years ago I looked these numbers up. They may have changed somewhat, but at that time, the California Youth Authority spent about $48,000 per year per inmate. The California Youth Authority being our juvenile justice system in the state of California. Is anybody here from Berkeley? Do we have any Berkeley students this year? All right. Are you mentors? Are you? All right. So we got some Berkeley people here. Berkeley undergrads? Any Berkeley undergrads? Okay. You don't have to be shy. My daughter went to Berkeley. She turned out okay. But the point I'm bringing up Berkeley, the reason I'm bringing up Berkeley is because at the same time the California Youth Authority is spending $48,000 per year per inmate, the state of California is spending $16,000 per year for every student in the California University State System, University System. So it's approximately three times as much to take care of a kid who's delinquent. And by the time you're done taking care of that kid who's delinquent, if you're lucky, you've brought him back to normal. You've brought him up to functioning. You've got him out of serious dysfunction and into normal. Whereas the kid at Berkeley, if you spend 3 or 4 years at Berkeley, by the time you're done, you've added some value, and that person's a constructive contributing member of society. So it's an enormous amount of money that goes into repairing the harm that can come about from family breakdown. So that's the fiscal implication, and here again are the references for that. Second point I want to bring up is the fact that the breakdown of the family has implications for the privacy of the family. And in order to understand this, I'm going to bring up a topic that I haven't mentioned yet, and I don't know if anybody in your other sessions will or has mentioned this, and that is the subject of no-fault divorce. Now, in no-fault divorce, the rule is that a person can get divorced for any reason or no reason. The rule prior to no-fault divorce was fault-based divorce, where somebody had to prove a marital fault. And if you were proven to be guilty of a marital fault, the other person could get a divorce from you and extract some resources from you, like the house and payments and so on and so forth. But there was a point to saying, my husband's an adulterer, right? Now, with no-fault divorce, we make it sound like two people are just mutually agreeing that they don't want to do this anymore, so let's go get a divorce, and let's make it as easy as possible for those two people to do, just be sensible grown-up people and realize that this is all over. But in fact, that's not how it usually goes down. Usually, it would be better to call it unilateral divorce, because one party can end the marriage for any reason or no reason. And in many, many cases, there is a reluctant party left behind. There is a reluctantly divorced person. And that means that person would like to stay married, but the law takes sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. Okay, and you don't usually think about it, but the law is taking sides here. The law is not being a neutral arbiter. The law is taking sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. That means there is somebody who must be separated from the assets of the family, possibly against their will. And that means usually the assets of the family, the most typical ones would be the family home and the children. And so now you have the government allocating those things to private parties who have done no wrong, You don't ever have to show any finding of fault or anything like that. And in fact, whereas adultery used to be a cause for divorce and would be penalized, now, very often, it's the adulterous partner who wants the divorce and who is in effect benefited by nobody ever asking any questions about what went on here, right? So the removing fault from divorce meant two things. First, it removed the presumption that the marriage would be permanent. And second, it removed the presumption that the marriage would be sexually exclusive. Okay, it bombarded both of those things with one blow. So now what you have is the government involved in managing the life of the family. Very often this is the case. Now, sometimes people can work it out, and it's all amicable, and they never go to court again, and the government's never really involved again. Matter of fact, one time I gave a talk in front of a bunch of matrimonial lawyers. Some of you may end up going into family law, and it was a room full of matrimonial lawyers, and I said, people get divorced believing that they're going to end the conflict by doing that. And you know what those lawyers did? They burst into laughter. Why did they burst into laughter? Because they spend all their time managing post-divorce conflict, right? That's what you do in family law. So you're in there for somebody gets a raise and the other person realizes they got a raise, so let's go renegotiate our spousal support payments. Somebody's doing this, so let's go renegotiate our kids, who's going to see the kids and how much time we get to spend with the kids. So you have the specter of the government managing the interior life of the family, including how much time you can spend with your own children, how much money you can spend, what you can spend your money on, whether or not they're going to go to church, where school they're going to go to. I give talks like this. People will come up to me and tell me their stories. I had somebody come up and tell me the following story. I know of a case where the judge was asked to decide what dress the girl should wear to the prom because the parents couldn't decide. Recently, there was a case that involved transgenderism. The mother and father were separated. The mother believed that their child was not of their birth gender. The father did not believe that. And the judge told the father that he had to treat his child by their new gender. Okay, so think about how intimately involved in the life of the family that has become. And in fact, there's no other area of life where we would put up with such a thing. We don't normally put up with this type of interference in the private in our private lives. It is only when marriage has broken down and the government inserts itself into this through no-fault divorce that all of a sudden there are tremendous concerns about our personal privacy that are coming directly through the breakdown of the family. Some would argue that this was the point all along, that from the feminist, at the perspective of a certain kind of radical feminist, this was the point. If you see the family as an institution that is oppressive, then you want to colonize it, take it over, get the offending party out of there, namely the father, the authority figure, get rid of that authority figure, replace that authority figure with the state governmental authority figure. Now, I don't know if how true that is or how many people believe that, but I do think it's safe to say that no matter what anybody intended, that's what we've ended up with. There's the complete reference for that. And then finally, the third implication I want to draw out is what I would call the deep philosophical implication of some of the stuff that we're doing. Are children a choice or are children a gift? Now, I suppose everybody here believes that every child is a gift from God. Every single human person is a unique and unrepeatable gift from God to us. Just as we were unique and unrepeatable gifts from God to our parents and our brothers and sisters, right? That's what we believe. But now the modern world believes that every child is a choice. Every child is a choice. And a problem to get rid of if you don't want one, and an object to purchase if you do want one. That's where the modern world is. And so the thought is that we don't really owe anything to children. We don't owe anything to children yet unborn. And there's an article that I'm going to pick on a Harvard law professor. It wouldn't have had to have been Harvard. It could be, I know there are some Harvard students here. It wouldn't have had to have been Harvard. It could have been a lot of different people saying this type of thing. But this is a person arguing against the concept of a best interest of a child who hasn't yet been born. And so here's what he comes out with. He comes to the and the reason for this coming up has to do with third party and assisted reproduction. And people saying, you know what, we should regulate those things because it's harmful to the child who is born. Child is born, doesn't know their father, has no connection with their father. By design, from the very beginning, you've got an anonymous sperm donor dad. This is unjust to the child. We should regulate that. Professor Cohen's response is no. That child would never have been born if it weren't for that. And so, therefore, we don't have any obligation to restrain ourselves in doing whatever we want. And here's what he says. Unless the state's failure to intervene would foist upon the child a, quote, life not worth living, any attempt to alter whether, when, or with whom an individual reproduces cannot be justified on the basis that harm will come to the resulting child, since, but for that intervention, the child would not exist. So he's articulating this as a legal principle. But you know, lots of people do lots of things thinking about the interests of their child who has not yet been born. You think about whether you're going to have enough money to take care of them. You think about who you're going to pick out to be their other spouse. You think about all these kinds of things because you want something better for your child than a life that's just barely above not worth living. The notorious Supreme Court decision that you perhaps know of is the Dred Scott decision, which is that a black man has no rights that any white man is bound to respect. We're very close to articulating, nobody's actually blurted this out yet, an unborn person has no rights that any born person is bound to respect. That's sort of what Roe v. Wade does, but Roe v. Wade has further progeny as we look down the pike to these other kinds of decisions. So these are some Romanian orphanages, some Romanian orphans. Do we owe them more than mere survival? Was it an injustice to these kids that they were left alone in this kind of condition? Do we owe them anything more? And so I think, in my opinion, what I want to leave you with is that as Christians, we make the claim that every child is an unrepeatable gift from God. What our opponents are claiming is that that's not true, and if it is true, it's irrelevant, that in fact, the child is an object of choice to get rid of if we don't want one and to purchase if we do want one. And I just want you to think about what we're doing when we make that move. When we make that move, we're leaving the realm of giving and receiving, loving and being loved, and we're moving into the realm of commerce and politics and law. We're shifting where we are. And so if a child really has no rights that anybody has to consider, when do they stop being the object that their mom picked out of the catalog from the sperm donor catalog? When do they stop being a product? When does that stop and then they become a full-on person? I would suggest to you that this issue is undermining the very basis of freedom itself, because every person needs to be equal on at least some basis. And always it has been in a Christian society, it has always been, we're equal before God, and we're equal as we come from God. And if we allow some people the right to manufacture people to their specifications, and then the child's supposed to be grateful, and never complain, right? We have created an inequality going across the generations. And it will be very hard to sustain a belief in freedom if that's how we start, if that's how everybody starts their lives.
You've just been listening to Dr. J speaking on the family as the foundation of society to a class of law students as part of the Alliance Defending Freedom's Blackstone Legal Fellowship. Stay tuned for the second talk, or head over to the Ruth Refuge to hear the Q&A afterward. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Moore's pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.